Hi there, this is Dr. Evan Osar with the Institute for Integrative Health and Fitness Education. Welcome to this edition of Integrative Movement Insider, and this is part four of a four-part series where we're discussing integrating the psoas and glutes and really developing a more optimal hip strategy, because so many of our clients are struggling with chronic tightness and or discomfort and are issues like labral tears and are degenerative changes of their hip that impact the things that they need to do, want to do, and ultimately the things they love to do. So we're sharing with you the strategies that we use with our clients and patients here in our clinic. And this is the same approach, the integrative movement system, is the same approach that we teach as part of our certification courses, the Integrative Corrective Exercise Instructor Program, which is a three-day intensive to introduce you to the integrative movement system, and then also the Integrative Movement Specialist course, which is a year-long intensive program. An important part of this process is having a process that you take your clients through. So you assess your clients, so you're determining their non-optimal and inefficient posture and movement habits. Then you're strategically using corrective exercise to help your client develop more optimal and efficient posture and movement habits. So I shared with you the modified Thomas test as one of our assessments for psoas length, psoas and hip flexor length. And then we looked at the happy baby position with three-dimensional breathing to help improve alignment and control of the thoracopelvic cylinder and how your client is ultimately using their psoas as part of their hip complex and developing more optimal positioning of their hip joint. Obviously, you'll also do some myofascial release around restrictions, and you'll also create a more optimal strategy through your corrective exercise patterns, your activation patterns, and we demonstrated the bridge pattern in the last video and why you want to teach your client how to keep their thoracopelvic cylinder aligned and really create a more optimal bridging strategy so your client is using their glute and not over gripping their glute and driving the femoral head forward. Now we want to take that integrated movement system, that process, into the third phase, which is integration. And that's where you really teach your clients how to incorporate that more optimal and more efficient strategy into their functional movement patterns, because that's ultimately what will help your client own the information that you're helping them adopt. And that's also why, or I should say how, you will help your client develop their most optimal and efficient strategy and really own it. Because what happens with corrective exercise and why corrective exercise often comes under criticism is because people will do their foam roll release or their activation patterns and some kind of neuromuscular re-education type strategy, and then they go right back to training the movement, the functional movement patterns the exact same manner as they did before, and they wonder why corrective exercise didn't work, or I tried corrective exercise, it didn't help my tight hips or my chronic labral tear or whatever issue they have going on. Because what happens is they did the release or their activation strategy and then went back to doing their movement patterns exactly the way they previously performed them. So therefore, obviously, nothing really changes. So one of the most important parts of the strategy, the process that you're taking your client through, is the integration piece. Integrating the concepts that you created in the fundamental, I should say through corrective exercise patterns, into the fundamental movement patterns. So now that you've helped your client release, activate, and you've taught them how to use your glutes appropriately, you want to teach them how to integrate that into some functional patterning. We'll use a split squat as an example, because what we want to do now is integrate the psoas and glutes into the split squat pattern, for example. So you want to make sure your client, again, aligns their hip complex, make sure their TPC is aligned, the thoracopelvic cylinder, so thorax aligned over top of the pelvis. They go into the split stance position, and now their split squat should look exactly, the alignment should look exactly as they did in happy baby position, as well as the bridge pattern. So you're teaching your client basically how to hip hinge and load their hips and then come up from that position, maintaining that alignment. The progression to that is doing an elevated rear leg split squat. So again, you're just elevating the rear leg and onto a bench or onto a bar, if this bar was a little bit lower for me. Another pattern we like to use quite a bit is pushing back against a bar and or object. So that way we're training both hip extension of the forward leg as well as the rear leg, because that will help us create that functional length of the hip flexors, more of the superficial hip flexors that many of our clients need, and really help our clients work on that extension phase of the gait cycle. So walking, what they need is that extension phase of that gait cycle. So here's how the pattern looks. So again, you know how to train the split squat. You progress them to the elevated rear leg split squat. And now from here, it's the same idea. That thoracopelvic cylinder stays aligned. Hands go on the pelvis, then the foot will go back against a surface that's solid that they can push back lightly into. So from here, the client stays aligned, really squaring their body up to that forward leg. And then they'll go into their split squat pattern. And as they come back, they keep that pressure of my right leg here, my right foot, into the surface. So that way I'm creating lengthening of that back leg. So that way I'm respecting the alignment of the thoracopelvic cylinder. I'm loading the front hip. So I'm still going anterior pelvic rotation. And then I come up into extension and lengthen. So that way I'm not going into hyperextension. I'm not trying to drive my thorax into extension. I'm trying to maintain this alignment. So it's control, load, and then come up out of that position, maintain that contact. So your glute should be activated here slightly. But again, I'm not driving that pelvis forward into posterior pelvic tilt. I'm just maintaining that neutral alignment as this hip starts lengthening. So it's loading and coming out of that position. Loading, coming out of that position. So great way to train both the front side mechanics as well as that lengthening in the rear side. So from the opposite side, set your client up, long spine, thorax stacked over top of the pelvis. Their leg will go up on the surface. They'll load and then come out of that position. Load, come out of that position without creating that hyperextension or that excessive posterior pelvic tilt. So they're loading the front leg, keeping that pressure with the back leg, the foot into the surface, and coming straight up as if they're gonna move forward that direction. Load, come up with no change in alignment throughout the pattern. Great way to activate the glutes, great way to get that functional lengthening of the rear leg for those mechanics that you need for gait, for running, for all those mobility type movements in the gait pattern or through the gait cycle. So great pattern for loading the glutes, training extension of that rear leg, as well as maintaining alignment and control of the thoracopelvic cylinder. So you're really getting a lot of bang for your buck with a very simple pattern. Simple in concept, hard to do because of balance, because of hip mobility issues. And that's why it's so important to take your clients through the proper progression. And that's why you start your client out, split squat, elevated rear leg split squat, and then progress them to that pattern where they're actually pushing back into the surface. So great way to train the concepts we're taking through from corrective exercise into those functional movement patterns. So this is Dr. Evan Osa with the Institute for Integrative Health and Fitness Education. Hope you enjoyed the series and helped explain how to improve psoas and glutes, how to integrate psoas and glutes into your functional movement patterns. Because remember, the goal really isn't to isolate these muscles out, it's just to discuss their functional role and how they work together in maintaining alignment and control of that thoracopelvic cylinder, as well as the hip complex, and how to use a process and having a process like the integrative movement system to strategically work your client through from assessing to using corrective exercise and then integrating those concepts into the fundamental movement patterns that your clients need to do to accomplish safely and effectively accomplish their health and fitness goals. Look forward to seeing you at an event soon. Make it a great weekend, and we'll be in Orlando, Florida. So look forward to seeing those of you that are attending that workshop. There's a couple spots left if you're still interested in attending and you can make it. Take care, make it a great weekend.